appreciate this invitation. I believe this was the first invitation I received to speak after I had been named president. I think I was named president publicly on February 21st, and I think I got the phone call from Tom on February 22nd or 3rd. I'm honored to be able to address the society of which I am a member. I have been a member since I was a graduate student. I appreciate the thoughts and the opportunity to share some views on what's happening at American universities. I suspect, though, I'm here in part because the price is right. That was a nice introduction. He didn't tell you that I studied fluid dynamics as a graduate student and did research in fluid dynamics. The faculty member, which is great training for the job I now have, is very fluid. Very dynamic, and it keeps me off the streets at night. I'm reminded of a story of a fellow who showed up at one of these talks with a terrible cut on his cheek, and he explained to the audience that he was so excited about the opportunity to share some thoughts with the audience that morning while he was getting ready for the day and shaving, he was so caught up in thinking about the speech and he wasn't paying attention, and he cut himself. And he went on to give a dreadfully boring 55-minute talk, put almost everyone to sleep, and at the reception afterwards, one of his friends came up to him and whispered to him, next time, concentrate on your face and cut the speech. Try to keep this not too dreadfully boring, not too long. I will be prepared when I am finished to entertain questions. I hope some of what I say is a little bit provocative, no, not so provocative that you question the wisdom of the search committee, but provocative enough to stimulate a question or two. What I would like to talk about tonight for a while is some of the challenges that I see facing American universities, and particularly American research universities. I want to talk a little bit about the history, some of the characteristics of these research universities, of which Iowa State is an example, and then talk about some of the challenges that I believe face us as research universities. How did this modern research university idea come into being? It is my view that it is largely, in this country, a post-World War II phenomenon. Prior to that, the American universities that were engaged in research were largely modeled after the German universities, the great example of the Eastern private universities, Johns Hopkins in particular, beginning PhD programs at the turn of the century, programs designed to train students in research. But the Second World War brought a major change, I believe, to the research missions of universities and made that research mission, particularly in areas related to science and engineering, although I believe it has begun to impact the whole university as a result of being a national priority. The Second World War in particular brought major research efforts in areas related to radar, to guided missiles, computers. The work at MIT by Wiener really has its origins, the cybernetic work has its origins in trying to track munitions for sighting purposes. And of course, the most spectacular and awesome and chilling example of all of that in the atomic weapons. All of that made clear that the world war that we were engaged in was clearly more than a competition of our industrial capacity or the size of our armies. Science and technology had become important instruments of national security, and the emergence of this nation as the world power made the research enterprise of the country a matter of high priority. There was a substantial shift and increase in support from the federal government, typified, for example, by the beginning of the National Science Foundation. It was right after the Second World War that Vannevar Bush, again from MIT, said in a paper, Science, the Endless Frontier, that, and I'm quoting him, on the wisdom with which we bring science to bear against the problems of the coming years will depend, depends in large measure our future as a nation. scientists like Einstein became celebrities, and this national importance of science and technology, I believe, has persisted now for fully half a century. Today we have presidential science advisors, we have science pages in our national newspapers, and the enterprise of research has grown to encompass many American universities, and we now all pay homage to the trinity of teaching, research, and public service, and it is deeply ingrained in the philosophy of these modern American research universities. Iowa State is a very good example of this development. Over the past half century, graduate enrollment has grown by a factor of 10. There were 407 students 50 years ago. Today there are 4,395. The percentage of the faculty with doctorate degrees has grown to be a substantial majority of our faculty. Sponsored research reached a new record level of $93 million last year, and there are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of research publications issued every year from practically every department of the campus. Obviously, research has been embraced by Iowa State as a central and integral part of its mission. We justify the research part of this trinity in a variety of ways today. It produces new knowledge, which is in and of itself desirable. On more practical grounds, we now use it as a tool to solve real problems, rich part of the land-grant idea. Problems like manufacturing, diseases like AIDS are illustrative of the problems that are being attacked today through research universities. Furthermore, I believe research has enabled this nation to compete, both in terms of its national security and economically. High tech, which is a cliche, but it is a real cliche, characterizes much of the strategy of this country for economic prosperity and national security. The basic research of our nation, in contrast to a lot of other nations of the world, is done largely at these universities, in part because the best minds are there. It is also done in part at these universities because we believe that research complements in the most fundamental way our teaching and public service missions. I have argued for a long time that it is essential to the continued development of the faculty. How else can one really keep up? Surely, if we're in the business of trying to teach people to learn, we should continue to learn ourselves. So the research university of today is very, very different than the institution before that Second World War. There are lots of ways in which it's different, and I want to list a few of them for you. First, the research agenda of today's university is set largely outside the university by the sponsors, such as the federal government. One of the consequences is a massive shift of where the research is done into areas like defense, like space, and like health. There's a good side to this. It makes our universities very responsive to national, state, and local agendas. I believe that is very desirable. The question of whether the balance between short-term problem-solving and the long-term underlying fundamental structure and the nature of knowledge, whether we're doing that balance properly, I think is a serious one. An example in my own field of engineering, one unfortunate consequence of this is we have largely ignored for a long time the technologies that surround the manufacture of goods. And in general, the engineering technologies that support the civilian economy. We're beginning to see a change in this, but it's clear that this is a consequence, in my view, of the agenda being set largely in Washington. Second characteristic of the modern research university is that graduate education is heavily subsidized by sponsored research and by undergraduate teaching assignments. For example, on this campus, a majority of our graduate students earn their way through either graduate teaching or graduate research assistantships. This is a good idea for many reasons. They are the faculty of the next generation. As Eric Block, the former director of NSF, has said, it's also a way of keeping a steady flow of young people through this research training pipeline so that our economy will not be starved of technologically trained people. Third, I believe the nature research university has shifted many faculty's allegiance toward their disciplines and toward these external research sponsors and away from their universities and from the field of education generally. Today's professors are, and I believe must be, far more entrepreneurial and in some sense more independent than the pre-World War II faculty. Research faculty are many times in the business of business as well as in the business of scholarly pursuits. The importance of external support for our research makes this a very, very competitive business. I'm one of those who argue that this competition for external research is a very desirable thing. It is the basis of the excellence of the American research enterprise. I believe the strength of our research enterprise is due in no small part to the very competitive nature of the grant and contract business that many faculty are engaged in. A fourth thing that's happened to the university because of this change in the nature of the research university is we have really broken down this idea of an ivory tower. Clark Kerr, who many of you probably remember as the former president of the University of California, said that over the past 20 years, faculty members have increasingly been drawn into more and more specialized research with the new opportunities available to them and into service as external demands for their specialized knowledge have greatly increased. I suspect a long time ago we tended to ignore some of these external demands. But today, if you're going to have a successful, aggressive research program, it requires more time on the road, it requires staying in closer touch with that external environment that provides much of the support. Selling has become part of our jobs, and you can't sell effectively if you're hidden away in a corner of the ivory tower. Finally, the modern research university has spawned a plethora of new organizational structures within universities to solve problems and to exploit opportunities for support. We have research centers, laboratories, institutes on this campus and others that are testimony to the emergence of these very specialized, problem-oriented research organizations. The traditional organization of the university into discipline-based departments is built on categories of knowledge that are older than any of us by many factors. They come out of, in some cases, the Middle Ages, and they surely are not always adequate to the kinds of problems we are trying to tackle today. This research university I have been talking about is largely the envy of the world. Students come to our campuses from all over the globe. The most prestigious universities in our nation and in the world are research universities, and the fruits of their research are everywhere, in biotechnology, in computers, artificial organs, all kinds of things. And this high-tech idea, which is still with us, this emphasis on research as a vehicle for practical reasons, for economic development, for national security, makes clear the widespread belief, I think, in our society of the importance of research and of research universities. But it is my assessment that not all is well in the research university today. There are a number of issues that are affecting research universities that are important and I believe deserve our attention and some careful thought. In many ways, they are the consequences of the success of this enterprise, but I believe if they are left untended, they are troubling and potentially threatening. And I'd like to focus on four of them because I think they are among the more serious threats. And the four I'd like to talk a little bit about tonight are the politicizing of research, the emergence of research fraud as a public issue, the questionable items that are charged to indirect costs for federally funded research, and this perceived tension between teaching and research at our research universities. First, politics of research. Today, research in this country is very big business. Tens of billions of dollars are spent annually on research. But I argue that research by its nature is a very inefficient process. Because it is a matter of national prestige, our national security and our national prosperity. Research at this scale is no longer immune to the pulls and tugs of politics. The cost of the superconducting supercollider is around $10 billion. The Human Genome Project, many billions. Space Station, it's unclear. It's tens of billions of dollars. These kinds of projects have reached a scale, a level, that require choices to be made and priorities to be set at the national level, and that is the stuff of politics. That is the stuff of making choices. The dollars involved are now at a level where the competition for these projects are rich political plums for the states who win them. The effort that Texas made for the superconducting supercollider is impressive indeed. And issues of distribution of those funds become very serious national questions. It is a conventional wisdom for those of us in universities that basic research is good, that all research is good, and we need to pursue our research wherever it takes us. It's part of what I believe we believe. Unfortunately, when the research costs tens of billions of dollars, that kind of philosophy is hard to fund, and it is hard to follow, and the decision-making process when this philosophy fails is largely a political decision-making process. As the scale of support grows, the level of funding takes on real political consequences, and many of us, researchers in particular, are both uncomfortable and not always real skilled at maneuvering in that arena. And the earmarking of federal research funds has brought researchers and politicians together in new alliances. It can, at times, give the impression that we're just another special interest group. I believe, though, the debate about earmarking needs to go beyond this. I believe it is a serious public policy debate, a larger debate, that we must grapple with about the new directions for research and the new emphases in research and what research is important to our economic future. The traditional structure of peer evaluation for research does not lead to dealing with the basic question, what kind of research does our country want and need? What kind of research should we emphasize, especially at a time of changing national needs? Many of us, I'm certainly one of them, are absolutely unabashed in giving talks about the role that research plays in fostering economic development. It tends to be a simplistic argument, but there are some real truths in this. And I do this in the attempt to convince political leaders, leaders of our state, of the need for additional funds at our university. But there is another important truth, and that is not all research is practical, and even if it were, we can't tell how it will be all the time. This American research enterprise has stood largely on the high ground of the pursuit of truth and a larger public interest during this post-World War II growth in research support. It is not clear to me that research universities in our community can compete with other political forces if we step down from this high ground position. The political arena is slippery ground, and it's an arena in which there are winners and losers. Research fraud is a second issue that I find troubling. There is clear evidence of people fabricating data. There is evidence of senior scientists forcing their junior colleagues to include them on work to which they had made no significant contribution. There is evidence of reviewers stealing ideas from proposals, and there are evidence of funds being spent for their unintended purposes, facilities being used for private gain. There's a wonderful article in Nature about the response of a biological system to an antibody that isn't there. More horribly, David Baltimore, arguably one of our great biologists, Nobel laureate, was put on the defensive in the public arena when it was claimed that the results were falsified in a paper that he supervised. Initially, Baltimore blamed the whistleblower, but in time was embarrassed when it was shown clearly that the study had been in fact falsified. Third, still raging about indirect cost charges of major research universities. The first victim of this debate was Stanford University. Don Kennedy, the president of that university, appeared before Representative Dingell's subcommittee in Washington. This probe has been extended to other universities, and I believe ultimately affects all of us. It has resulted in Kennedy's resignation. It's yet another arrow from the political arena. The treatment of Kennedy was very tough and typically political. I believe it has indicated, at least in that arena, that universities have become fair game. We are not considered different or distinctive because of our roles. We're just like the rest, seeking federal funds. The standards that are applied are largely political standards, not legal standards, and they're based on what can stand public scrutiny. I believe this debate about indirect cost has hurt all of us. It has not been a good thing, and it illustrates that this federal government that we have grown used to as a supporter of our research can be very fickle when it serves the political interests. The danger in all of this, I believe, is that it undermines the public's confidence in this research enterprise. Much of what we do at a university in research today is beyond the understanding of the public, even the educated public. They have to accept its value and its validity largely as a matter of faith. They must trust us. And when that faith is destroyed, the entire enterprise suffers, and I believe that could be quite unfortunate. So as members of a research university, as scholars, we have a very serious need to be vigilant and to have a commitment to honesty, and where there is fraud or inappropriate behavior, we must step up to it quickly and decisively. The fourth challenge, and I believe the one that is important, maybe perhaps most important, is this perceived tension between research and teaching at the modern research university, and I believe it must be addressed. Make no mistake, I include myself among those who accept the complementary nature of teaching and research as an article of faith. In fact, I not only believe it, I have seen it. I have seen it in my own career and in that of others. And what I mean by the tension between teaching and research, I don't mean the trivial idea that people are either good researchers or good teachers, and that good research is somehow antithetical to good teaching. These are old arguments that are often advanced by people who do neither teaching nor research well, and they do not deserve a careful response. My concern has to do with the real tensions that grow out of the time pressures that are inherent in the multifaceted responsibilities that faculty have in research universities and the specialization that is required to advance the state of the art in these various areas. Let me try to elaborate. To the extent that the demands on faculty for teaching and research and service grow, there are trade-offs of time. It's inevitable, and they must occur. There's no escaping it. If there's a perception by faculty and others, even if it is incorrect, that research is more important, teaching may suffer. Not because the faculty can't do the teaching well, it will be because of time. And the heightened competition for support, for proposals, means more time writing proposals, more trips to sponsors, more time. And that time can be taken away from efforts to enhance teaching. My experience, my observation, is that the impact on teaching is not typically in the classroom, but it's outside of class, where opportunities to counsel with individual students, advising discussions, the kind of informal interactions with students, particularly with undergraduates, is what really suffers as a result. I was shocked by a study by Yankelevich, Skelly and others of the National Public Opinion Survey firm a few years ago, did a study for a major research university of public opinion leaders in the United States, and they found that a substantial majority of these public opinion leaders believed that undergraduates do not benefit from studying at a research university. These people saw no obvious synergism between the research activities of the university on the one hand and undergraduate instruction on the other. If this notion that teaching and research are complementary, the idea that I accept as an article of faith and fundamental to the concept of a research university, then we've got some important opinion leaders to convince otherwise. I find this notion that there is not this complementarity to these two parts of our mission very dangerous, very troubling. We've got to change this view. We've got to do this to command the resources we need to carry out this enterprise. Another, and for me, equally troubling aspect of this tension of time and between teaching and research and its impact on specialization, its impact on the curriculum. To advance knowledge through research today requires a depth of understanding that often leads to specialization. It is in the nature of the knowledge that's about us. The specialization is institutionalized through the departmental structure that I talked about earlier. This specialization makes the discussion of curriculum issues among the faculty extraordinarily difficult, if not impossible. I have seen this with my own colleagues, even within departments. I had the privilege, I guess it was a privilege once, of chairing a curriculum committee to review the curriculum. And what intrigued me is that as we debated this further and further, it was clearly balkanized and bartered. It was an aerospace engineering curriculum, but the people who were interested in the thermal sciences said to those who were interested in structures, give us our three courses, we'll work that out, we'll let you have your three. The people in thermal sciences had absolutely nothing to say about structures, and the structures people had absolutely nothing to say about the thermal sciences. And it's not just within departments. Not many of my engineering colleagues are aware of what is happening in literature today. Mathematicians know little of biology. Biologists know little of mathematics. There is this specialization that makes very difficult a debate about education, particularly general education. I believe part of the message of this assessment movement that is in the country and is beginning to overtake universities is that this historic responsibility that the faculty have had in setting the curriculum is not being fulfilled as effectively as people would like. In the absence of some broader understanding, then the faculty, and I include myself in this, are unable to talk meaningfully about liberal education or general education. We each know our specialties, and we are very reluctant to tread in the domain of other experts. This results, I believe, in a smorgasbord of courses, one from here, one from there, a kind of balkanization of the curriculum. And although it may, it often doesn't add up to a real education, a good general education. In my own field of engineering, I believe it is one of the reasons we don't do manufacturing well. Hardly anybody knows the whole system. We only know pieces of it. Well, how are we going to deal with these kinds of issues? I believe it is essential that the universities try to deal with these, because if we don't, others will. And worse, this wonderful enterprise that we have pledged our careers to could be jeopardized. I'd like to argue that in tackling these issues, we start with the most fundamental first, and that is to ensure that this kind of university, a research university in which teaching, research, and public service define our mission, that in fact these various aspects of our mission really do complement each other in a way that enriches our students, particularly our undergraduate students, and in a way that the public that supports us understands, comprehends, and supports. We must be true to this land-grant mission. To do this, I believe, for example, we have to find ways to integrate teaching and research for undergraduate students as well as graduate students. I am a proponent of research opportunities for credit for undergraduates. That's one approach. Bringing current research into the classroom is yet another. Term projects that provide opportunities for students to review new research opportunities, yet a third. In research and public service through some of these problem-oriented research centers is another means for bringing this integration together. Taking advantage of some of these multidisciplinary research centers we have as a way to bring both graduate and undergraduate students into this marriage of teaching, research, and service is yet another example. And I believe it is essential for the faculty to try to find ways, forums, for educating each other about our various disciplines. We have to gain the knowledge necessary for an informed debate about the curriculum. This is fundamentally important. It is the faculty's responsibility. Among the organizations of a university that could do that is Sigma Xi. It is one of the organizations that does transcend the disciplines. It brings together people from a variety of areas. It provides a vehicle for organizing this discussion for the mutual education of us all. But it will take time and it will take energy. It might be interesting. I'm convinced if we don't do it, someone else will do it for us. So I believe there must be an integration or a better blending of the teaching and research and service missions of our university, particularly as they affect undergraduate education, and we had better find and value those people who make this kind of integration work well. In fact, if we don't know how to figure out how to do this blending of teaching, research, and service more effectively, all three of those missions will suffer ultimately. It is in this sense that I think we should recommit to the total land-grant mission that defines this university. It really is what we say we are, and my sense as I visit around Iowa and read what is going on nationally and visit with others, it's also what's needed. In Clark Kerr's paper that I mentioned earlier, he quotes Robert Louis Stevenson, who said, "To travel hopefully is a better thing than to arrive." And Kerr says, "It might almost be said that the perfect university is an imperfect one seeking perfection. I believe that blending teaching, research, and service in a way that complement each other better is this search for perfection that is what we should aspire to. They cannot stand alone. They must combine to benefit each other and provide the kind of opportunity that will provide the best educational opportunities for all of our students." On that, I would be happy to take some questions. There are a number of things happening. First, as we try to do more, for example, in building this much more substantial research enterprise here at Iowa State, which has happened at other institutions, we've done that largely by expanding our resource base. And so we have engaged particularly the federal government, but more recently, there has been more support for research from the private sector. It's happened in a number of universities around the country. So that the sources of income have become more varied, and some of them are private. We have become more aggressive in trying to create special opportunities on the campus through private funding from our alumni and other friends. The Durham Center, recreation facility, those are examples of that. But also, there is a trend, I believe, in the country, and it concerns me, tell you why in a second, of seeing the fruits of education being visited largely upon the individuals who are here at the university, largely upon our students, and less upon the society generally. I have this sense that the explanation for the movement from grants to loans, federal level in terms of student financial aid. The increasing willingness all over the country to increase tuition far faster than inflation. University of California's tuition went up 40% this year. The University of Missouri system has committed itself to increasing tuition for students at the Higher Education Price Index plus $200 per year for five consecutive years. Take tuition from $2,000 to $4,000 a year. The University of Texas system has instituted tuition in the last few years. There is a general tendency to place more, a larger fraction of the burden on students. And I believe underlying this is a view that they are the primary beneficiaries and they ought to bear a larger fraction of the cost. This question of what the balance is between the private interests of students as individuals, being educated, being given opportunities, having their lives enriched as individuals, and the impact of education generally on the society is a serious question, and it ebbs and flows in terms of how we perceive that balance. But if there is something fundamental to the land grant idea, it was this faith, this notion that if we all invested publicly in this kind of university, we would all benefit from this kind of university. And I am therefore troubled by this larger trend nationally. It troubles me. To personalize this, I couldn't have gotten through school without public support. The oldest of six kids from a very ordinary working class family. It just simply wouldn't have been possible to finance my education, and my parents had to sign a check, or I had to, together we couldn't have done it. So I'm concerned about that. The tension for this university and others is funding is tighter. Resources we have are relatively limited. Appropriations from state government, number one, tuition and fees, number two. Much of the other funding we receive, for example, for research, is restricted funding. It is, has a specific target that it's intended for, and we can't use it for these more general purposes. Whether that indicates the movement towards privatizing the university or not, that's perhaps stronger than I would state it. But I believe this is a serious debate. It's a debate taking place in Iowa as well as elsewhere. To the extent that we will be true to these land grant ideas, I think we will continue to try to find ways to mitigate against that so that students who are able, but not necessarily financially able or intellectually able, will still have the opportunity. It's a challenge. Yes?
In your opinion, do you think students have the kind of voice that they need to be able to give their input to the kinds of things you were talking about, for example, curriculum, or into the research opportunities that, you know, granted would help them quite a bit in their education?
Yeah, and I would argue that on a couple of grounds. First, a question of who ought to make the judgments about curriculum, and I believe the most learned among us should, and that argues for the faculty having the primary responsibility. It's historically been true in universities. And second, given the 3,500 colleges and universities in the United States, there is wide choice of the different kinds of curriculums and programs of instruction that people can choose from. So there's lots of variety out there. I don't think choice for students is limited. My concern is as we become specialists as faculty, that assuring that this balance between a practical and often specialized education on the one hand and a liberal general education on the other, which is another basic idea of these land grant universities, becomes increasingly difficult to achieve because we don't have the basis for having the debate about what the general curriculum should be. We don't know enough about the general curriculum. Yeah.
I have a question about, you mentioned those three areas that are of importance to you, service, research, and teaching. And in the advancement or in gaining tenure for an individual faculty member, I was wondering, we can assess research, we can look at it, and we can see if an individual is contributing. Do you have any thoughts on how a person or how a university university can assess advancements or effectiveness in teaching and service?
Sure. Let me speak specifically to teaching, because if my view is that you can quantitatively measure both research and teaching. You can count papers, you can count proposals, you can count invited talks. More difficult questions are deal with the qualitative aspects of research. How significant is it? How enduring? And those are judgments ultimately that have to be made by peers, and they're imprecise but important. Similarly in teaching, you can count the number of students, you can count the number of courses taught, you can count the number of courses developed, or textbooks written, or papers written. Qualitative aspects of effective teaching are more difficult to measure. I believe, in my own experience, that students are a useful source of information on this, and I have been a proponent of student evaluations. I believe they ought to be confidential because I believe the basic thrust ought to be to improve teaching. I think students have lots of effective ways of finding out how teachers are. There's a network that was very effective when I was a student, and I have all kinds of reasons to believe it remains effective. But the deeper questions, not only of whether the students have learned material and are prepared for yet the next course and are achieving in some narrow sense the growth of knowledge, but harder questions about whether they have had their appetite whetted intellectually and whether they leave this university not only educated but prepared to continue to be educated, whether they have been inspired a bit. Those are more difficult things to judge, and again, I tend to turn to the peers. But I think you can evaluate both. Service, similarly. The more difficult questions are questions of the quality of the activity. I also believe that even when it's difficult to measure these things and to assess them, that the only worst thing is to not even try. Because in doing so, you say it's not very important. So I argue for comprehensive, multifaceted measures, and rely heavily on the peers, but not exclusively. I believe particularly in teaching the students ought to play a role in that, if only to say to them that we really are serious about this.
Yeah. I think you're aware of this continuing debate about land-grant universities, like in terms of where they, what audience should they serve? Are they an elitist organization, or are they an egalitarian organization or institution? And this refers to economic considerations as well as to intellectual considerations. And this begins to surface, perhaps in the intellectual area, when one debates entrance requirements,
sure,
for example, or as one begins to design the curriculum, as one begins to work in other opportunities. How would you respond to the question or the statement that the view that you're proposing seems to favor the elitist side rather than the egalitarian side?
I don't think I agree with the conclusion. If that's the impression you have gotten, then I have not communicated very effectively. In terms of our history, there's just no question that the land-grant universities were an instrument of public policy to expand access. That's clear. And it succeeded. It succeeded admirably, I believe. In a real world of limited resources, the question of how effectively one uses those resources in creating access is a real challenge. I believe that universities should have admission standards, not so much for elitist reasons, but I believe it most deeply because I think we need to give students some indication of what is required for success. I was of an era and went to an institution where in my first course in chemistry, the professor gave that old cliche about look to the left and look to the right. I find that a bankrupt idea. I believe believe we ought to have admission standards so that students come to us with some reasonable expectation that if they apply themselves, they will succeed. And for those who don't have the requisite background or ability, that there be other avenues. I am a proponent in that sense of the community college system, of transfers. So I would argue for greater access. I don't necessarily believe that means open access to anybody, to any institution, because it's too inefficient in the use of resources. But all of my views are, I feel fairly strongly, that both for the development of individuals as members of the society, for the full richness of their lives, but also for very practical reasons of where the good jobs are and what we need in the society, I argue for more people being educated. How to do that efficiently, what our role is in that system, is a matter for serious discussion and debate. I don't have much quarrel with the current entrance standard that says if you graduate, I believe, in the upper half of your class in Iowa, you're admitted to the university. It seems to me to be a relatively open, liberal admission standard. And for those who don't meet that, there are yet other ways that they can ultimately gain access to this university. I would argue for that. I think the notion that issues of efficiency aren't serious and important questions, I just don't agree with that. Frankly, under the current circumstances, they have taken on. I don't think that's bad at all, frankly. I think the fact that we aggressively recruit students is a good thing, because it's a part of the test of that market. To the extent they come, I believe they perceive we offer rich opportunities. To the extent they don't, demographics aside, it's a signal that perhaps you've got to adjust a little bit. I was pleased to see our enrollment be higher than we had predicted, and I think that's part of it because we're working harder. But this is a real competition. Yes?
I'm enthused about your philosophy between the marriage of research and teaching and sharing that with undergraduates. I work for the honors program, and we set up a certain program for our freshmen, matching them with faculty on campus, do a spring semester worth of research. Needless to say, I don't think that philosophy is widely shared among the university. Granted, these are freshmen, but we think giving them their first taste of research and from finding out what these students give us as feedback, they get turned on by it and they want more. How do you make, or what's the best way to get these researchers to share and take the risk with students? How can we give those students more opportunities?
I haven't had a lot of experience with freshmen in research, but the very best graduate students I ever had, I first brought into my research program as undergraduates. In fact, I would regularly volunteer to teach the first course in fluid dynamics so I could get my hooks into the best students. And there was already one or two in the class that had a sort of spark and interest. Opportunities for research among undergraduates is not for everybody. We've got a large fraction of our students who are working and frankly don't have the time and all they can do to keep up with their regular classwork. But for some, it's a very important experience. It satisfies a desire that many students have for that kind of direct interaction with faculty, search for mentors, and it provides them with, I think, a very enriching educational opportunity to really tackle unstructured problems, to see somebody who is skilled in the art of tackling difficult questions do it, to watch it, to be part of that. And I think it inspires lots of them into graduate school. One of the experiences that I had with these students that I work with is that when it came time for the graduate school decision, we didn't argue about stipends. They were happy to get whatever to take whatever I can get them. It was interesting to me. So I would argue, first, to make the point to faculty that trying to attract the very best undergraduates into research is in their interest as researchers. It is in their interest as part of this university community. And to the extent that we can find resources to encourage that, I would like to do that. I think that would be a good idea. I must admit, in this current budget environment, it is difficult to find additional resources. You see, funding agencies, the National Science Foundation in particular, setting aside money to encourage this kind of thing. I think it's a good idea. And for certain kinds of problems, frankly, my experience has been I think the most important idea, and the one that I would like to emphasize, is that we must make good this idea of the complementary nature of these three parts of our mission. That defines this kind of university. And if we get drawn into the trap of believing they're not complementary and are antagonistic, then I think we fall into the question the kind of university we are. And I happen to believe in this kind of university. I would like to see it work and prosper and really bring forth all of the promise that is here. And one of the issues is our undergraduates want to have some contact with the faculty. To the extent you make those opportunities available more readily, it benefits them and the institution. Yes, sir.
Well, I'm sure that many of us here, your support of the basic concepts of the land grant institution is encouraging. However, there's one thing in the offing proposal to cut the extension by 12.5%, I believe it is. Doesn't seem to fit well with that concept at this time. Can you speak to that?
Yeah, let me correct you in one sense. It is not a cut of extension, it is a reallocation within extension. Extension's budget is not being cut. The funds that are there are being reallocated within extension, and that is in response to the budget stresses we have all faced. It is the view of the leadership in extension. I haven't reviewed the proposal specifically, so I don't want to comment on them specifically, but it is in part to try to come to grips with the reality of the current level of funding. In taking budget cuts that have come down in the last year or so, some of them have been done in what I will call, of necessity, opportunistic ways. Positions were vacant. It was easy to take the money out there. But it has led to an extension program that is not as well balanced, focused as the leadership in extension believes, and some changes have to be made to accommodate that. Extension is a rich part of the land grant tradition. Perhaps the unique thing about land-grant universities, this notion of service, of taking the knowledge and the assets that are at the university and sharing them very widely and very broadly. It's had an enormous impact in Iowa. The impact in particular in agriculture is substantial and profound. But the world is changing. The access to information today is much different than it was 100 years ago when we started. The purveyors of that information are more than universities. And what the extension's role in the modern land grant university, I think, is a subject for serious debate. It is changing. It's changing in terms of the national level and the funding there, and it is changing at the state level. What is going on today in extension, though, is an adjustment to, a reaction to, and dealing with the budget reductions that have taken place previously, and frankly, it's what the whole rest of the university is trying to wrestle with Dean Schrock's task force. How do we accommodate the current level of resources, which is less than it was a year ago? That's the issue. Yes?
A comment maybe 15 years ago, there was a British scientist who wrote on research management at the time of fixed budget, and made a comment which is somewhat germane in terms of the investment of the goal. He said, of course, under those circumstances, the only way to start something new is to stop something old. And the first requisite for good research administrator is that it be a good ruthless butcher. The comment with the guy for extension, if I understand it correctly, what was the problem? If you have fixed resources and you've got demands to do some new things, you have to stop some old.
And frankly, for people of my generation, this has not been our experience until recently. I've had some older friends, educators, who have told me that you have been in the golden age, you just don't know. And we are having to accommodate. I believe part of what is happening is that we are at a confluence of a nation in a much more
talking about, and it's our turn. I mean, I hear a lot of that outside of the university. Sympathy, understanding of the difficulty, wish it weren't the case, but sort of welcome to the 90s kind of, I mean, I heard that from people, and these are friends of education. These are not mean-spirited people who do not care about our enterprise. They care deeply about it, but they believe it is in the nature of our time, and we have to adapt to this. Yes?
I hope you'll forgive me changing tack a little bit again from that to something else, but you've talked a lot about specialization among faculty and also obviously in students also,
sure,
in specializing in research and things like that. Is, well, let me back up a second. I know in a lot of the technical majors there are a lot of required courses, there are a lot of credits that are required among a lot of the different technical majors. Is there room, in your opinion, for a core curriculum of many other, a broader base of courses? It seems to me like a lot of students that are get into the technical majors at a school like this get so involved in those particular areas, that specific area, that they just do not have the kind of broad education which I think a lot of people thought that people used to get.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it wasn't quite as specialized. People would get into philosophy and history and things like that. Do you think that there's a need for a core curriculum? Is there any need for more broad-based education?
I mean, I have some private opinions as a single member of the faculty, and I want to be say this precisely. The president does not determine the curriculum, and it's good. I do have opinions. I tend to be one who argues as a member of an individual faculty for a broader curriculum. It's part of my own experience, my biases about what are important and what endures, but the most important message is that this is the responsibility of the faculty, and what I am arguing for is to find ways to have that discussion within the faculty. And it is a difficult one, and the nature of our institution makes it quite difficult. We are large and complex, we're all extraordinarily busy, but beyond that, the deeper issue is that to do our jobs on a day-to-day basis, we have become very specialized. I know a lot about fluid mechanics. I know less about biology. I know less about history. And the danger in that specialization is that you know so little that you can't even contribute to the debate. You don't know the debate. You don't even know the questions, much less the answers. And I'm arguing for trying to deal with that. It's a difficult thing to do. It takes time and energy. But I believe it is part of the nature of this land-grant university to try to find that balance between a practical and therefore specialized education and a richer, more general or liberal education. Where the balance is varies with time, to be sure. But I'm one that argues that we ought to try to tackle those, and my experience has been, as a participant, that these are extraordinarily difficult to do. It's hard to have a discussion when everybody's speaking a different language. We're not hearing the questions. It tends to get balkanized and bartered, and out of that comes a hodgepodge, and that's unfortunate. Part of what's neat for me about being at a university is being with a lot of people who have different views of the world, of truth, of beauty, and understand how you solve a lot of different kinds of practical problems. There's a sort of richness in that that I enjoy participating in, and I think is an important part of the education we provide students. How to do that is a challenge, and all I'm trying to suggest is we try to find ways to begin the discussion. And you don't want it led by the president, frankly. I don't think that would be good. Because ultimately, it's the faculty that has to do it. Never wants to do the teaching.
Dr. Jischke, I think we better...
One more and then
one more.
Oh. Nothing worse than an unasked question.
Fine.
back on the subject of the extension therapy.
Sure.
With the reallocation, will the mission change in some sense, or what would be sort of...
I wouldn't say the mission would change, but the particular areas in which the mission is played out will. Put superficially, probably fewer things done. But the notion of extending the university's knowledge to solve problems, to help people make decisions, start taking money off, real things happen, either intended or not. You can kid yourself that you're continuing to do what you did before, but you've got less dollars, you don't do it. So I don't see it as a change in mission. I see it as a reallocation, reorganization,